New study shows a long overdue Cascadia megaquake could destroy and sink cities. Right now, beneath the picturesque coastlines of Oregon and Washington, a geological monster is stirring. The Cascadia Subduction Zone, a 700-mile fault line stretching from Northern California to Vancouver Island, is not just due for a catastrophic earthquake, it's overdue. And when it ruptures, which scientists say will happen with absolute certainty, it will unleash one of the worst natural disasters in North American history. Be sure to keep watching until the end of this video, because I'm going to reveal shocking scientific predictions about permanent land collapse that coastal officials are desperately trying to prepare for, but can't. So don't click away. You won't want to miss these terrifying geological certainties that mainstream media rarely covers in depth. This isn't just some vague, far-off threat we're talking about. The Cascadia Subduction Zone has a 10 to 30% chance of producing a full margin rupture within the next 50 years. That might sound like acceptable odds until you understand what's at stake. A magnitude 9+ earthquake that will shake for a brutal 5 minutes, followed by tsunamis up to 100 feet, and then, most devastatingly, the permanent sinking of coastal areas by up to 6.5 feet in minutes. The geological evidence is undeniable. Scientists have drilled core samples from coastal marshes that tell a grim story. Massive Cascadia earthquakes have occurred with shocking regularity over thousands of years. On average, they happen every 300 to 600 years. The last one, January 26, 1700, exactly 325 years ago. We're already living on borrowed time. Don't believe it? Just look at the ghost forests that haunt the Pacific Northwest coastline. Groves of dead cedar trees standing in saltwater marshes, killed when the land suddenly dropped during previous quakes. These eerie monuments are nature's warning signs, testaments to the sudden land subsidence that follows these megathrust earthquakes. Native American oral traditions provide further evidence. Tribes across the region pass down stories describing violent shaking, coastal land that sank beneath the waves, and tsunamis that swept away entire villages. One Yurok narrative describes how the earth would quake and quake, and then the water would rise. These aren't myths or legends. They're eyewitness accounts that have been confirmed by modern science. What makes the situation particularly alarming is that the fault is currently locked. The Juan de Fuca plate is stuck against the North American plate. It's not slowly releasing pressure through small earthquakes. Instead, enormous strain is building up, mile after mile, day after day. When it finally breaks free, the release of energy will be catastrophic. Modern detection methods have given scientists unprecedented insight into this mounting pressure. GPS measurements show that the coastal regions are being compressed eastward at about 40 millimeters per year. This compression is like slowly drawing back a bowstring, and the longer it's pulled, the more violent the release will be. What most people don't realize is that this pressure isn't building uniformly. Recent studies using seafloor pressure sensors have identified locked patches along the fault where strain is concentrating. These areas will likely be the epicenters of the most violent shaking when the rupture begins. And one of these locked patches sits directly offshore from heavily populated areas. The most alarming new data comes from underwater landslide evidence. Researchers mapping the ocean floor have discovered massive submarine slide deposits that could have only been triggered by Cascadia earthquakes. The scale of these slides indicate earthquake forces far beyond what most buildings in the region are designed to withstand. Have you ever considered how differently you'd live your life if you knew a disaster of this magnitude was imminent? Many geologists working in the Pacific Northwest have quietly moved their families away from coastal areas or invested in property well above projected tsunami inundation zones. The clock is ticking. Each day brings us closer to a disaster that will fundamentally reshape the Pacific Northwest. The United States Geological Survey, FEMA, and state emergency management agencies are now treating a major Cascadia event not as a matter of if, but when. Emergency planners expect the death toll to exceed 13,000, with economic damages surpassing $32 billion. And that's likely a conservative estimate. The Cascadia earthquake will rewrite the geography of the Pacific Northwest in minutes. Coastal areas that have been inhabited for centuries will be rendered uninhabitable overnight. Infrastructure designed to last decades will be destroyed in seconds. And unlike hurricanes or wildfires that we can't see approaching, this catastrophe will strike without warning, transforming lives in an instant. When the Cascadia Subduction Zone ruptures, it won't just be one disaster. It will unleash three catastrophic events in rapid succession, each magnifying the others in ways that emergency planners are only beginning to understand. The first wave of destruction will come from the earthquake itself. Unlike the brief shaking of California's quakes, which typically last 10 to 30 seconds, a Cascadia megathrust will unleash violent ground motion for an excruciating 5 minutes. 5 full minutes of building swaying, bridges collapsing, and underground pipes snapping. The energy released will equal roughly 30 times that of the strongest California earthquake on record. Modern high-rises in Seattle and Portland will oscillate like pendulums, their foundations tested beyond design limits. Older, unreinforced masonry buildings, which make up about 75% of structures in many Pacific Northwest towns, will crumble within the first minute. Landslides will sever critical mountain highways, instantly isolating coastal communities from inland resources. But the earthquake is just the beginning of this cascading catastrophe. The second phase, the tsunami, will arrive with terrifying speed. The seafloor displacement will generate massive waves racing towards shore at jet aircraft speeds. Unlike distant tsunamis that trigger warning systems hours in advance, Cascadia's tsunami will reach coastal communities in just 15 to 30 minutes after the shaking stops. These waves won't be mere storm surges. We're talking about walls of water up to 100 feet high, taller than a 10-story building, carrying incredible destructive energy. The tsunami will penetrate miles inland through river valleys, scouring away everything in its path. Few structures can withstand such forces. Those that survive the earthquake will likely be swept away by the tsunami. Have you ever wondered what would happen if a major coastal area became permanently uninhabitable overnight? How would our society handle hundreds of thousands of instant climate refugees? Before answering the question, don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. But it's the third disaster, the one rarely discussed in media coverage, that will permanently alter the Pacific Northwest landscape: co-seismic subsidence. This is where the research gets truly frightening. While the earthquake and tsunami will cause immediate destruction, the sudden sinking of coastal lands will create permanent, irreversible changes. Recent studies led by Dr. Tina Dura at Virginia Tech have revealed that when the Cascadia Fault ruptures, vast stretches of coastline will instantly sink by up to 6.5 feet. This isn't gradual subsidence occurring over years. It happens within minutes as the compressed North American plate suddenly springs upward offshore while the coastal edge drops downward. The implications are devastating. Areas that were safely above sea level will be permanently submerged. The federally designed 100-year floodplain will instantly expand by up to 116 square miles, equivalent to 70,000 football fields suddenly underwater. Major highways, including critical evacuation routes, will be submerged, trapping survivors in place. What makes this triple disaster uniquely catastrophic is how each element compounds the others. Tsunami-damaged buildings that might have been repairable will instantly sit in newly formed bays and inlets. Emergency response routes blocked by earthquake debris would normally be cleared in days, but with roads now underwater, some communities will remain isolated for months. Climate change adds yet another multiplier to this disaster equation. Sea levels are already rising along the Pacific coast, about 8 inches over the past century. scientific projections show another 4 to 6 feet of rise by 2100. When combined with sudden subsidence, coastal communities face a double displacement. First, from the earthquake-induced drop, then from the steadily encroaching ocean. The Cascadia event will dwarf other famous disasters. The 2011 Tohoku earthquake and tsunami in Japan, which caused nearly $360 billion in damages, provides the closest modern comparison. But Japan's infrastructure was specifically engineered for such events, with tsunami walls, earthquake-resistant buildings, and well-rehearsed evacuation plans. The Pacific Northwest has none of these advantages at comparable scales. Hurricane Katrina, which flooded 80% of New Orleans, offers another parallel, but with a crucial difference. After Katrina, the floodwaters eventually receded. After Cascadia, much of the flooded land will remain underwater permanently. Rebuilding won't be possible in many areas. Entire communities will have to relocate. This isn't a scenario from a disaster movie. It's the scientific consensus on what awaits the Pacific Northwest. The unique combination of prolonged violent shaking, near-immediate tsunami arrival, and permanent land subsidence creates a threat matrix unlike anything emergency managers have ever faced in North America. The morning after the Cascadia earthquake, more than 15 million people across Washington, Oregon, Northern California, and British Columbia will wake up to a fundamentally altered reality. For those who survived the initial disaster, the true scale of the catastrophe will only start to become clear as daylight reveals a transformed landscape. Communications will be among the first systems to fail completely. Cell towers toppled by shaking, fiber optic cables severed by landslides, and power substations damaged by liquefaction will create an information blackout. In our connected age, imagine the psychological impact when millions suddenly cannot contact loved ones or access emergency information. Those cell phones we rely on daily will become useless pieces of glass and metal within minutes of the rupture. Critical infrastructure that took decades to build will be crippled or destroyed in a single day. The Northwest's major ports, Seattle, Tacoma, Portland, Vancouver, will experience catastrophic damage from both the earthquake and tsunami, followed by the permanent inundation of loading areas due to subsidence. These ports handle more than $70 billion of goods annually and serve as crucial links in national and global supply chains. Their extended closure will trigger shortages across North America within days. Transportation networks will suffer unprecedented fragmentation. The Interstate 5 corridor, the economic spine of the West Coast, crosses numerous bridges and unstable fill areas vulnerable to liquefaction. Over 7,000 bridges in the affected region are expected to fail or suffer serious damage. Highway 101, which serves as the main coastal evacuation route, will be severed in hundreds of places by landslides, collapsed bridges, and newly formed inlets created by subsidence. The isolation of communities will reach levels not seen in modern American history. Coastal towns that survived the tsunami will find themselves cut off from the mainland by newly formed bodies of water where roads once existed. With most airstrips damaged and harbors filled with debris, these communities will face weeks or months without significant outside aid. Emergency planners estimate that some areas could remain isolated for up to a year, a scenario that demands levels of self-sufficiency few modern communities possess. Perhaps most concerning is the region's critical energy infrastructure. The Northwest power grid contains over 15,000 miles of high-voltage transmission lines, crossing mountain passes and unstable terrain. Damage to this system will plunge millions into darkness for weeks or months. Fuel supplies will rapidly dwindle as damaged pipelines and submerged distribution facilities halt the flow of gasoline and diesel. Without power or fuel, other recovery efforts become exponentially more difficult. The water crisis will emerge as perhaps the deadliest secondary disaster. Water treatment facilities along rivers and coastal areas will be damaged by shaking and inundated by tsunamis or subsidence, Underground water mains, already fragile due to age, will rupture in thousands of locations. Oregon emergency officials estimate that some communities could be without clean water for up to 3 years. Without water, urban centers become uninhabitable within days. The economic devastation will extend far beyond the physically damaged areas. The Cascadia region represents over $1.5 trillion in annual economic activity. Its sudden offline status will trigger market panics, supply chain collapses, and insurance industry chaos. The estimated price tag for a full margin Cascadia rupture starts at $32 billion, but quickly escalates into hundreds of billions when accounting for long-term economic impacts. Some economists project it could become America's first trillion-dollar natural disaster. What makes this scenario particularly haunting is that much of the land rendered uninhabitable will remain so permanently. Unlike hurricane-ravaged areas that can eventually be rebuilt, coastal zones that sink below sea level will never be reclaimed. Saltwater intrusion will contaminate groundwater supplies. Agricultural lands will become marshes. Communities with centuries of history will simply cease to exist. The preparedness gap is perhaps the most frustrating aspect of this impending catastrophe. Despite knowing the risk with scientific certainty, the region remains drastically unprepared. Emergency fuel reserves are insufficient. Water storage capacity is inadequate. Building codes have only recently begun to account for the expected shaking duration. And public awareness remains disturbingly low, with surveys showing that many residents still have no disaster plan or emergency supplies. Recovery will take decades, not years. The rebuilding process will face unprecedented challenges from permanently altered geography. New highways will need to be routed around newly formed bays. Water systems will require complete redesign. Population centers may need to shift inland. The coastline itself will be redrawn on maps, with new inlets, lagoons, and estuaries where communities once stood. This isn't some distant theoretical threat. The imminent Cascadia earthquake represents the greatest natural disaster risk currently facing North America. The geological evidence is clear. The pressure continues to build. And when it releases, whether tomorrow or 20 years from now, millions of lives will change in an instant. The question isn't whether we'll face this catastrophe, but whether we'll face it prepared or caught utterly off guard. The scientific warning couldn't be clearer. Time is running out for meaningful preparation. If we continue on our current path, the Cascadia earthquake won't just be a natural disaster. It will be a preventable human tragedy of historic proportions. If this video has opened your eyes to this impending threat, share it with your friends. Your subscription helps us continue to cover these critical issues that mainstream media often overlooks. Now, check out our next video on the end screens or our natural disaster playlist. See you soon.